Hello, I'm Jess Gillam, and thank you so much for joining us for this concert by the Philharmonia Orchestra. It's part of the Philharmonia series Human Nature, Music for a Precious Planet, generously supported by Kate and Andrew Davis and the Shelby Cullom Davis Charitable Fund. The stream performance is supported by Citi. A warm welcome to all of our supporters and friends who are all over the world. Thanks to you, after 18 months, the orchestra is back at full strength tonight. Our players make the Philharmonia, and the friends keep the Philharmonia playing. From just £5 a month, you can join the Philharmonia family and make a real difference. Join today at philharmonia.co.uk/friends. Well, this evening, we offer you a feast of Strauss. Born in Germany in 1864 to a musical family, Richard Strauss started composing aged just six. He continued until he was well into his 80s and wrote some of the most expressive and iconic works in the classical repertoire. In his orchestral works, he harnessed the power of over 100 musicians to describe nature, stories, and emotions. We celebrate his music this evening, starting with the dramatic and life-affirming Also, sprach Zarathustra, and followed by the vivid Alpine Symphony, a musical guidebook to the sights and sounds of the Alps. This is Strauss in all his glory, music full of soaring melodies, rich harmonies, and dazzling orchestration. The orchestra will be conducted tonight by Santtu-Matias Rouvali, the Philharmonia's brand new Principal Conductor. And speaking of Santtu, I'm very pleased to be able to sit down with him for a quick chat before we begin. Santtu, thank you so much for joining us and taking the time.
Thank you.
This is going to be your first concert as Principal Conductor of the Philharmonia in their London home. An exciting new chapter for you and for the orchestra. What are you looking forward to about this new adventure?
Well, of course, it's my biggest honor to be the next Principal Conductor after Esa-Pekka. And since first I came to this orchestra, it was around year 13, I got immediately fallen in love with this orchestra because they are world-class players, so fast to understand what I want, and the chemistry seems to work from the beginning. So I'm really much looking forward to our touring, for example. With this orchestra, there are no limits.
And tonight, there are no limits in your programming either. You've chosen an all Strauss program. What is it that draws you to Strauss and his musical voice?
Well, one point was that after Corona, you know, we played with reduced forces all the time, smaller program. So now, when we are allowed to perform, I decided I want everyone on stage and a little bit extra as well. The other thing in Strauss music is that there are so many layers in the music. For example, sometimes it's hard to choose which is the primary layer and which is the secondary. And that makes Strauss music interesting to me because you can actually pick it up by feeling and in the now moment, which is on the stage and the concert, you suddenly take out a little bit of the second voice or the, even the third voice more. It changed the whole hearing, how the music sounds, but it sounds still good. It doesn't ruin the first melody line. And then with all these big triplets, I'm a big fan of the big triplets and divisions of the triplet rhythm. Da, da, ga, da, da, ga, ga. I'm this kind of, not a mathematician, but I want to do a game with these complex rhythms inside the music. And still it sounds beautiful. Nobody don't think about the rhythm in Strauss music.
Maybe that comes from your beginnings as a percussionist of meticulous rhythm.
That might be. I have been always interested in the rhythm. And I always think the music, first thing is the rhythm, then comes the melody and the harmony.
And Strauss was, as well as a composer, of course, a conductor. And he once said, "It is better to conduct with the ear than with the arm. The rest follows automatically." What's your approach to
Yeah, I would
conduct?
Say that's a challenge. Like, if somebody can conduct Strauss without getting sweaty, that's a good challenge. I can't do, let's say, after 40 years, I can do without sweating.
Well, let's talk about the legendary opening of Also sprach Zarathustra. It starts with those famous three notes by the trumpet, followed by the timpani pounding before the rest of the orchestra finally joins in. We have this amazing burst of ecstasy. There's so much drama within just 2 minutes. How do you approach such an iconic opening as a conductor?
This is kind of easy part because you just come there and low C. And then you give the cue to the trumpet. Do, so, do. At the same time, feeling majestic without doing nothing. But still the music is so majestic. But you are like just a statue as a conductor.
Well, we'll let Santtu go and get ready for this evening's concert. In the programme notes for the Berlin premiere of this piece in 1896, Strauss wrote, "I do not intend to write philosophical music or to portray Nietzsche's great work. I mean to convey through music an idea of the evolution of humanity from its origin." However you choose to listen to this great work, reflecting on our purpose and place in the cosmos, or simply letting yourself be filled with the glorious sound of a huge orchestra, we hope you enjoy it. Here now is the Philharmonia Orchestra with Also sprach Zarathustra.
We'll be right back.
What an incredible way to open this concert. The drama and radiance of Strauss's musical response to Nietzsche's philosophical treatise of the same name, Also sprach Zarathustra. Well, Strauss's last major symphonic work, an Alpine symphony, lies ahead for the rest of this concert. A tone poem of epic proportions, it marshals a small army of performers to reenact in music the story of a hiker who sets off before dawn to climb a mountain, encounters a storm on the descent, and returns to safety at the end of the day. Gillian Moore, Director of Music at the Southbank Centre, is here to talk to us about this piece. Gillian, thank you so much for joining us. It's wonderful to see you.
It's a great pleasure, Jess.
And we have over 100 musicians on stage. There's two sets of timpani, thunder sheets, a wind machine. What can we expect from this piece?
Well, this is a symphony. It's, as you say, it's a tone poem. It's using the full mastery of the orchestra that Strauss had by that stage acquired. It was 1915 when he finished it. He was, don't forget, one of the world's great conductors as well as composers. So he really knew how to paint a picture so vividly in the orchestra. And I was also thinking that through the 50 minutes of this work, I was thinking about the context, about the year in which it was written. It was written in 1915, at a time, the early days of cinema. Germany was a big player in cinema in those days. And it seems to me almost like a film as well, because it's taking you from scene to scene through this day in the mountains from dawn till dusk and painting these really vivid pictures and stories over the whole course of the 50 minutes of the piece.
And you mentioned there that story from dawn till dusk. Is there also, if we peel back the layers, a wider narrative, a deeper story under there?
Yeah, well, of course, with Strauss, there's always much more than just, you know, I'm going to tell you a story about a day in the mountains about, or about Don Juan. There's a much more philosophical basis to it. He wrote it, he started thinking about this piece literally just when he heard about, in 1911, about the death of his friend and to some extent rival Gustav Mahler. And of course, Mahler was also, like Strauss, loved the Alps, loved the mountains, loved painting pictures. But his impetus was this kind of struggle with religion, with God. And Strauss was so absolutely, vehemently atheist. He was a great follower, as we've heard in Also sprach Zarathustra, of Nietzsche, the idea that God was dead. He thought the biggest curse and the thing that was holding back the German nation from real greatness was this sort of addiction to the church, addiction to God. And he said, I intend to call my symphony the Alpine Symphony, but I'm also thinking of it as Antichrist, since it involves what moral purification through one's own effort. This struggle, this day in the mountains, this climbing the mountain, overwhelming all these obstacles and storms and sliding on ice and going through thickets, that's the story of the human struggle, the human life on our own without this recourse to a higher power. And that's what he was trying to get across in this symphony, as well as just a picture of a wonderful portrait of nature.
And that ties into the series running here at Southbank Centre.
Yes, the Philharmonia's series, Human Nature, is all about that, about our relationship with nature in the particular context of the climate crisis. This autumn, we have the COP26 conference in Glasgow. This is really well timed. We're really looking at music, and the Philharmonic Orchestra is going to be playing music and thinking about how we as humans interact with nature, both in these wonderful ways of talking about it, writing poems about it, and also what we are doing to the planet.
And you mentioned the way that Strauss can paint a picture through music. We heard the sunrise in Also sprach Zarathustra. We'll hear another in Alpine Symphony. He can paint these incredible colours. Are there some particular moments you would be listening out for in this piece?
So we start when it's still dark, with the hiker setting off before dawn. The mountain is there, looming through the dark. And we have this incredible orchestral effect, which to me sounds really modernist. We don't think of Strauss necessarily as a modernist, but it's the orchestra. They're going this and playing these descending scales, and the strings are holding on to the notes. So you get this shimmer, and the mountain starts to emerge on the low brass, this dark shape through the shimmer. And then we get the sunrise. It's very different from the Also sprach Zarathustra sunrise, which is just so stark and so simple. This is the same descending melody that we've got, sort of shimmer of the darkness, but it's blazing out, big descending melody on the whole orchestra, this triumphant moment of sunrise. That's a major moment for me. Other ways in which he paints pictures, there's an amazing moment where we come across a waterfall with, you know, glistening harps and high woodwinds, etc. We have an incredible storm. It starts amazingly with these single raindrops in the orchestra that just get faster and faster and faster, and then the full force of nature comes through the orchestra with the swirling winds and strings and thunderous percussion, and of course that wind machine sort of swirling away. And there's an organ as well, which the great Royal Festival Hall organ in this case, and that really shows the terrifying power of nature, which eventually the hero or the heroine in this story overcomes.
Can't wait to hear it and to hear all of those depictions. And you mentioned that the piece was written in 1915. Perhaps you could tell us a little bit about the context or about Strauss's life at the time. Where was he in his career?
Well, he was a very famous composer. He'd written all these other tone poems. This is the last of those. He also was a great conductor and an opera composer. He'd just finished Der Rosenkavalier. He had just built himself a beautiful villa, because he was very successful by that stage, in the Alps in Bavaria, where he came from. So he was looking out on these mountains that he portrays so vividly in this piece. But I think we should also think about the wider political context at that time. This is a time when he finished it in 1915. And of course, the First World War was raging at that time. And you don't necessarily think of this piece as being like, say, the Rite of Spring, which was written at more or less exactly the same time, Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. You don't think of this piece as being really something that is terribly portentous about the war. But there is that very human element to the Alpine Symphony. And there also is, in the storm scene, I would argue, there is real violence. I think Strauss can't have been impervious to what was going on in the world, in the wider world. And I think he was really hoping for that, some kind of peaceful resolution, which, of course, in the end, didn't happen.
And tonight's concert will be Santtu's first concert here at Southbank as principal conductor of the Philharmonia. What are you expecting from his interpretation of this piece, or what are you looking forward to about it?
Well, I think this is a great match. I mean, the Philharmonia really excels in this great German repertoire. They're brilliant at that. They're brilliant at colour. And what Santtu brings is this fresh energy. He is a man of nature himself. As I understand it, he lives in a forest. You know, he's very connected with nature. I think he will really understand the piece from that, from the inside, from that point of view. And any performances of his I've been to, he just manages to bring out amazing, unexpected colours and things you've never heard before in a piece. So I just can't wait to see what he does with the Alpine Symphony and the Philharmonia.
Well, thank you so much, Gillian. It's been fascinating to hear your insights, and thanks for taking the time to talk to us.
Great pleasure. Thanks, Jess.
Well, let's head back into the hall now to hear Santtu conducting the Philharmonia Orchestra in Strauss's An Alpine Symphony.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that incredible performance as much as I did. We heard Santtu-Matias Rouvali conducting the Philharmonia Orchestra in an Alpine Symphony. Thank you so much for joining us this evening, and goodbye from us all here at the Royal Festival Hall in London.